Penguin Random House Audio presents Dad Camp, a novel by Evan S. Porter. Read for you by Sean Patrick Hopkins. For my dad, John. Sunday. 1. If we don't win this girls' 9-11 softball game, it might actually be the end of the world. Well, my world, anyway. I'm leaning against the chain-link backstop just next to our dugout on the third baseline, fingers gripping the metal for dear life, the late summer sun beating on my neck, which would be sweating from the nerves even if it were January. Number 9, a girl named Isla, is up at bat, and the count doesn't look good. 1 ball and 2 strikes. We only have 1 out left, but I feel, let's say, pretty good about who's coming up in the lineup, if we can make it there. Number 9 takes a ball. 2-2 now. At 12, she's the tallest and biggest girl on the team by far. She's here only because of a late birthday and a clerical error, so everyone assumes she's our secret weapon. Every week, parents of kids on the other team sit up with a nervous energy when she steps into the batter's box. Little do they know that she's utterly, undeniably terrible. She hasn't quite got full control over her fast-growing frame yet. Her stance is elbowy and awkward, like a baby ostrich learning to run. Great girl, great kid, but she's more effective as psychological warfare than as an actual player. So, we might be in trouble. The pitcher winds up and launches a fastball. Number 9 swings hard and, miraculously, gets all of it, driving it deep into left field. A shocked, "Oh!" escapes my throat. "Go, go, go!" I shout as she drops the bat, sounding like a drunk guy at a bar who bet way more than he could afford on this game. She takes off for first. The ball just gets over the outstretched glove of the fielder, and 9 takes second. A bad throw skips between an infielder's legs, and just like that, she's on third. This is the part where the team behind me should be going nuts, but I steal a glance over my shoulder, and our bench is a sea of disinterest. Girls snapping selfies, tying their baggy jerseys up into cutesy side knots, chatting lazily. Bodies turned completely away from the action. I've never had as hard of a time getting a team engaged as I did this year, with this age group, with these girls. But no time to worry about that now. There are 2 outs, a runner in scoring position, and Avery's up. She jogs to the plate, adjusting her helmet over brown hair sticking out in 2 braids on both sides. She's never cared about game day hair before, but this season's hottest look, apparently, is pigtails, and Avery has adopted them along with the rest of the team. She wears her signature eye black, smeared like war paint all over her face. I catch up with her and pull her aside. "So, it all comes down to this," I say in my most ridiculous movie trailer voice. "Yep," she says, tightening her batting gloves, mostly ignoring me. Par for the course lately. "We're all tied up. All we need is a base hit to bring Isla home. Just give it a little nudge into the gap." I point out a gaping chasm between 2 infielders. "And we walk off as champions. Think you can do it?" Avery scoffs. "Dad," she starts, "it's Coach Dad out here." "I'm not calling you that," she says, tightening her batting gloves again, apparently unhappy with their snugness. "And I know what to do." Now, here's the thing. It might sound a little cocky, but Avery and I have won more than our fair share of little plastic trophies that read number 1 or great job. She eats high-stakes scenarios like this for breakfast, and I mean that almost literally. Over Lucky Charms most mornings, she makes me quiz her on situational play. The more convoluted, the better. So she does, in fact, know what to do. But there's always the chance that something goes wrong. A millimeter can be the difference between a home run and a pop fly, the difference between a joyful romp around the bases and Avery furiously bludgeoning the dirt with her bat. Today, of all days, I'd much prefer the former. I've got something I need to tell her, and she's not going to like it. At all. So naturally, I've put it off until the absolute last possible second, which is right around as soon as this game is over. If I don't want my head bitten off, I need her in a good mood. If we lose, who am I kidding? She won't let that happen. I'm sure of it. Please God, don't let us lose. Avery brushes past me and settles in at the plate. I give a signal to number 9 at third, waving my arms in the air like a crazed chimpanzee, flicking the tip of my nose, then folding one leg up like a flamingo. She stares back blankly from underneath the brim of the batter's helmet for what feels like an excruciatingly long time. "What?" she finally says aloud. I'm really not sure how I could be more clear. We've practiced these, I think. I sigh, then gesture animatedly toward home plate. Now she nods, finally getting it. The pitcher winds up and delivers, and to my surprise, Avery doesn't appear to be aiming for a controlled line drive through the gap. She cocks back and uncorks a wild, Paul Bunyan-like swing instead, and completely misses. Number 9, who took off for home the second the pitch took flight, skids to a stop, confused, and runs back to third. "Avery, just lay it down," I yell. She glares back at me. "Or, you know, trust your judgment, or whatever. Woo!" I clap pitifully. The pitcher reloads. Another perfect pitch, and another huge swing and a miss from Avery. The count is 0-2. It's not unlike her to come out aggressive and get behind like this. She has the skill to come back, and she knows it, which is exactly what gets her into trouble sometimes. I know what's more than likely about to happen, but it doesn't stop me from chewing what's left of my fingernails right off and spitting them out into the dirt as I watch. Seconds later, though, I'm proven right. The pitcher adjusts her headband, digs her feet into the mound, and fires off another. Avery cocks back, not letting up, only this time she absolutely crushes it. The ball rockets into deep center, way over the outstretched gloves of the hapless fielders. The team parents erupt in cheers from the bleachers, while the girls casually look over to see what's going on, mostly unenthused. I even spot a subtle eye roll or two. There she goes again. For years, Avery has stood out from her teammates, but they all used to look up to her for her prowess on the field. This year has been different, to say the least. Avery throws her arms up triumphantly and tosses the bat, then jogs the bases. 2 runs score, we win. Moments before she stomps on home plate, I position myself a few feet away and crouch down, arms wide for a customary congratulatory hug, like we've shared so many times before. I see her running toward me down the baseline, and for a moment, I can see all versions of her at once. 4-year-old Avery, who forgot to drop the T-ball bat and carried it around the bases. 6-year-old Avery with the batter's helmet drooping over her eyes. 9-year-old Avery, who was finally big enough to tackle me to the ground in a fit of giggles. Beaming, I ready myself for the embrace that's been the highlight of my week for as long as I can remember. It's a little uncoach-like, I admit, but it's one of the few fatherly indulgences I allow myself when we're out on the field. Back when I was in Little League and my dad was the coach, he bent over backward not to treat me any differently from the other boys, to the point where it felt like he was actively ignoring me. I spent years working my ass off in hopes of getting a wink or a warm pat on the back, anything, before I finally gave up and dropped out of sports altogether. Avery speeds up, sprinting home to secure the win. But instead of us colliding into an epic hug, she whizzes past me with a small, unintentional, I hope, shoulder bump, which sends me careening backward onto my ass. From the dirt, I watch as Avery skips over to the bench, beaming, hands up and prepped for an avalanche of high fives. None come. Most of the girls are already abandoning the dugout like a sinking ship, jogging to the infield for a few robotic handshakes with the losing team. Quickly, their attention turns to the 9-11 boys, who just finished up a game on a field catty-corner to ours. They approach each other in packs, eager for the rush of unpracticed flirting. But
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.